So what do the root beer float, the cheeseburger, and the Denver boot all have in common? They're inventions from right here in Dtown. Who knew? That's right, we're a creative town. We've got some awesome inventions and some great ways to nurture our local inventive spirit. Let's dig in.
We'll look at the Inventor Lady and Camp Invention for the budding young inventors. Plus, we'll show you some more of those awesome local inventions you never knew about.
Rachel West here. Let's find out more. This is delicious.
As we mentioned, Denver is home of the appropriately named Denver boot. No, not that kind of boot. This kind. Also called the wheel clamp or parking boot, it was invented back in 1944 when Denver police needed a way to help traffic enforcement and not have to tow so many cars.
This is one of the original or standard boot devices that the city of Denver had started putting in use in the mid to late 50s. As you can see, this boot device actually has a patent for the Denver boot. It originated here in Denver. A gentleman by the name of Frank Marug, he was the one who actually made the design.
Frank's day job? He was a musician with the Denver Symphony Orchestra, of course. Yes, multi-talented. The device was patented in 1958, and the rest is history. Denver Public Works still has that first original boot, along with a collection of others throughout the years. Very cool. So, what instrument did Frank Marug, the Denver boot inventor, play? The drums, violin, or clarinet? The answer, he played the violin.
So, do you have an invention or an idea for an invention, but you don't know where to go? How about the Inventor Lady? Of course.
We met up with Rita. Yes, the Inventor Lady herself. We asked how she got the name.
It was one of those ironic moments because I was down here at the Denver Metro Chamber of Commerce and a gentleman saw me and he goes, "I know you, you're the Inventor Lady, that Inventor Lady." And I'm thinking, works for me. So I went back to my desk, inventorlady.com was available,
yes.
And we were off to the races.
Well, that's how it starts.
It was perfect.
You never know when that stroke of genius will hit.
That's right. That's right. The mother of invention.
Which is you, kind of, right, for Denver?
Yes. I help inventors get from I have an idea to the marketplace. So if they Google inventor help, you know, inventor questions, inventor lady, I'm going to pop up at the top of the list.
So how does this process work? Do I have to already have like a prototype built, or can I just come in with just this crazy idea? How does it work when I come to you?
We like crazy ideas the best.
Nice.
Because people can come in and say, "I've got an idea, what do I do?" And so we can kind of keep them out of the traps.
Okay.
And our tagline is "Don't spend a dime before it's time." So we want inventors to learn about the process. So our meetings are free. We do the Inventors Roundtable in Loveland, Denver, Colorado Springs, Salt Lake, and Boston every month.
Oh my gosh.
And so inventors can come in and say, "You know, I've got this idea, what do I do?" So then we walk them through the steps so that they can learn the process before they've spent any money.
Well, that's interesting because, you know, I think sometimes you get really excited. If you want to invent something, you want to just see it made before you, but you're saying there's actually a process that you have to go through.
Absolutely.
Things to learn. So what are some tips just off the bat, you know, if you have an idea, do this, don't do this sort of thing?
Well, it's important to understand that there are very specific steps to the process so that you don't get burnt.
Yeah.
And so do some looking around. Take the blinders off, because inventors, you know, they think, "Oh, I've got this really cool idea." They don't really want to find something. And I had a lady that said, "I've got this really cool idea, I want to get a search done." And I said, "You know, give me 15 minutes. And I called her back and said, "You might want to buy that one on Amazon. It'll be a lot cheaper and faster." And so, you know, part of it is just getting people to really understand how vast the marketplace really is.
So how many people do you work with here in Denver alone on a regular basis?
Dozens and dozens. We've got hundreds of inventors that we've, you know, for some of them, it's giving them closure. It's like, you know what? You need a stomach lining and a budget to do this.
Yeah.
And some of them say, "Not going to happen. I just don't have one or the other and I'm willing to risk it." So for a lot of people, closure is the best thing we can give them. For the others, it's really helping them, you know, go through the steps the right direction so that when they get through the gauntlet, all right, they've really got something to sell.
So Rita, the question is, do you have any of these inventions we can touch and hold and look at?
I do. I do.
Of course she does. I spied them over there with my little eye. See, I was testing you.
I'm prepared.
She is. All right, Inventor Lady, let's go take a look at these awesome Denver and Colorado inventions.
Perfect.
Off we go.
Oh, here's the table of goodies and inventions, Rita.
Absolutely.
I'm excited.
Got wonderful Colorado inventors.
All right, well, let's choose one and get started. I want to know about all of them.
Okay, excellent. Well, let's start at this end then and work our way down.
Okay.
All right, this is called the disposal genie. This was invented by a woman down in Pueblo. All right, stuck her hand down into a garbage disposal one time and she goes, yuck. So she came up with this product. It fits into the garbage disposal so your forks don't go down there. Nothing that should be falling down there does anymore.
But everything that has to go down goes down.
Exactly. Exactly. And we licensed this to a supplier for Home Depot. It is now sold in the Home Depots and Lowe's all over North America.
Oh, wow.
So, very cool little product.
All from Pueblo, Colorado.
Pueblo, Colorado. This one was also done by a man down in Colorado Springs. All right. It fits. It's a clear cover. It will actually glow in the dark then put over a doorknob. So, it's for people that are older, maybe have some arthritis. The doorknob is hard to get a hold of. It works really well outside. So if it's really cold or really hot, your doorknob, then your hands are protected.
Can I open it?
Very cool. Absolutely.
I want to look in here. Oh, cool.
So it was funny because they sold about 1 million units of this, and the distribution network for their company was his wife at the dining room table every night. And she got to a point, she says, you know what, I'm out of here. I'm going to Florida to see the grandkids, figure it out, but I quit.
Yeah.
And so he licensed it then. We licensed it to a company in Utah that sells to the home health care industry.
Yeah.
And now he goes to the bank to deposit his royalty checks and goes to Florida with his wife to see the grandkids. So very fun. This is done by a retired engineer. Any wooden gate will eventually sag.
Yes.
All right. So this is a quick $20 fix. It will put then your gate back up in the proper alignment.
Wow.
Everything that you need to install it, except for the screwdriver, is in this little package.
How did he come up with this idea?
Because he had a sagging gate.
Right.
You know, really? Colorado inventors are amazing.
Yeah.
We are in the top 10 every year of the number of patents filed for and the number of patents issued.
Here in Colorado?
Here in Colorado.
Way to go.
We are really
inventive.
All right, so this one is for babies. We've done everything from baby products to tractors. So this is for the baby, all right. It's a teether. This gets cold. It's stainless steel.
Okay.
So you put it in the freezer, you're out at a restaurant, you put it in cold water, it gets cold. The handle never gets cold.
Wow. Talk about ingenuity.
Yeah.
This solves another problem.
It does.
For many people.
It does.
We appreciate
and
that.
The patent is not as much on the product, but on the machinery that makes the product.
Really? So the way that it's
very
manufactured?
Cool. Absolutely.
Interesting.
Absolutely.
Okay.
All right.
Good.
So this one, can you open it?
Oh, goodness.
It is a child-resistant box. So for anything that you don't want little fingers getting a hold of, you can put into the creative case.
Hold on. Did it say that it was Rachel West proof too?
There's a little secret to it. Push.
Yeah.
Okay, let me show you the secret. That's why I brought two. Okay, you push on the sides,
yeah.
And you push in on the lid.
Oh,
it's got spiders in it just for you.
Oh my gosh, yeah, I wasn't even paying attention to the spiders.
That's right.
The patent on this then, is it on the product itself or on this technology?
It's on the technology. They can actually use, it's the way the ridges go around the top. And we launched a Kickstarter campaign on Monday for this product. And it has been government tested for child resistance. So it does now have the certification as a child resistant product.
Wow, way to go, Colorado. All right.
So, absolutely. So this is one of the really cool ones.
I've been eyeing this.
This is called Pine Rite. It is the best soap you will ever use. It is made out of the beetle kill pine.
All right, okay.
So a gentleman up in Fort Collins, so we do cover the state here. All right, up in Fort Collins owned a lot of land, you know, and the beetle kill was just destroying the trees.
Yeah.
And so he would strip the poles and sell them for furniture, but then he had these big piles of bark and needles and the smaller branches, and he goes, there has got to be a way to make a better hot dog. So his technology, his patent is on the machine. He puts these leftovers, this junk, into the machine. The machine sucks all of the moisture out of it. So all he's got is a dust, a pine dust. He mixes lanolin and borax with it. All right. This is one of the few products that I know of that is actually manufactured here in Colorado and shipped by the palletful to China.
Yes.
We export this to China.
High five.
Yeah.
I like
absolutely.
To hear that.
Absolutely.
Well, what an ingenious solution to a really big problem in Colorado.
Yes.
You know, a way that you would think there would be such waste involved, but he's turning this into a product that then helps solve another problem keeping everything clean.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's amazing.
I like this.
All right. Natural. That's one of the other big uses for it is at camping.
Yeah.
You know, where you don't want to pollute streams
yeah.
or anything. All natural.
I love it.
Speaking of all natural, this one, I've got a little demo. This is a cleaning product, all right?
Oh my gosh.
All natural. All natural. It's made out of spices that you find in your kitchen. So if you were truly desperate, you could use it as a spritzer on a salad. But in the meantime, it will take pet stains out of carpeting.
It's got some spice to it.
It does. It does. It's spices. Cleans grout. Any stain from, like I said, a pet. It'll clean blood out of clothing, out of carpeting, grease. It will take tar off of a motorcycle or a car. It will clean your grill. And it's all natural.
Who would have guessed from this little spray bottle that it can do all of that?
All right, well, there's still another product left, and I wonder who could help us with this pet-friendly product. Is there anyone nearby that could help us? Oh, here we go. Rhonda, a little birdie told me that you could help us with this pet-friendly product. Nice to meet you, Rhonda, by the way.
Nice to meet you.
You like that smooth transition, how I did that?
Yeah.
You're a pro.
I was trying to be inventive. Yeah. I don't know. Okay, so tell us about this. I know this has got a really cool story.
Well, this is my invention. It's called the Tagabiner, and it replaces the S-hooks and the split rings that we usually use to put our tags on our dog's collar. This is a device. It's a closed loop, so your tags won't fall off, and you can easily remove it and go to a different collar. And one of the reasons I did this was in the last 10 years, they've come out with all these really cute pet collars.
Yeah.
I wanted to be able to change my dog's collar to Christmas or summer or whatever. So I thought there needed to be a better way to very easily, I mean within seconds, take the tags from one collar and put them to another collar.
That was super easy how you did that.
Yeah.
So where did you come along the process? How did Rita help you in the process of bringing this all together?
Well, she helped get us together with a engineer, which we would have had no idea where to find a product engineer like that.
So you had the connections.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is a nice simple package, but it shows exactly what it does. How about the name? How did you come up with the name?
I came up with that.
Nice. Okay.
It is a combination of the word tag and carabiner.
Nice. Well, I guess I'll be taking these tagabiners home to my doggies, and we'll see you later. No, I'm kidding. No, but thank you for this. This is great. If any of these go missing, I don't know what happened, particularly the soap or, you know, any of these.
I'm sure if you twisted my arm, I could give you some.
Really?
Yeah.
You would give Dtown some of these?
I would.
Thank
you.
I
would, absolutely.
We appreciate it. Well, I'm going to give you double high fives.
Thank you.
Yay. I just invented that.
Thanks to Rita, Rhonda, and all our cool local inventors, and to those who use these great products.
All right. I've got my Tagabiner, my Creative, my Pine Right, and more. I'm ready to go. More after the break. I see a lot of cleaning and fixing going down after this.
Did we mention Denver is the home of the cheeseburger? Why, yes, we did. Actually, there are others who claim to have invented the cheeseburger before we did, but...
Here it is, the monument to the old Humpty Dumpty Barrel Drive-In in North Denver, and the trademark for the cheeseburger. Yep, it's totally ours.
Oh yes, way back in 1935, Louis Ballast from the very cool Barrel Restaurant got the trademark.
On this site in 1935, Louis E. Ballast created the cheeseburger. His restaurant, the Humpty Dumpty Barrel Drive-In, was Colorado's first drive-in and was commonly known as the Barrel.
So, there you go. Okay, when is National Cheeseburger Day? May 18th, September 18th, or November 18th? The answer, mark your calendars now. It's September 18th.
Oh, can I order some shredded wheat? Thanks. Oh, also another Denver invention. Thank you very much. Ooh, shredded wheat from Dtown.
Henry Perkey invented shredded wheat in Denver in what year? 1890, 1904, or 1927? The answer, it's a classic, all right. It was invented in 1890. So is inventing just for adults? Not so much. In fact, not at all with Camp Invention. This is totally cool. Let's go check it out. First, we met up with Brenna, a Camp Invention director.
So Camp Invention is a week-long camp for kids that are kindergartners through fifth graders, where kids get to come in and do a bunch of different things to practice being inventors.
Nice, so it's really an immersive experience to figure out what it's like to have that first stroke of genius to actually creating it, right?
Yes.
Brenna told us that Camp Invention is backed by the U.S. Patent Office and the National Inventors Hall of Fame. Their programs help children and others explore science, technology, and their own creativity, inventiveness, and entrepreneurial spirit. Sweet!
The favorite usually is the one where they bring in an electronic that no longer works and take it apart and repurpose it into something else.
So how about we find a local inventor, see maybe what's been created recently, and then get our hands into some problem solving.
Sounds good.
All right, Brenna will lead the way. Off we go. Well, look who I've tracked down. It's the famous young inventor, Liam. How are you?
Good.
I can tell you're doing good. How old are you?
I'm 8.
And what grade are you in?
3rd.
All right, all the important details are out of the way. Tell me about Camp Invention and what you liked about it.
I like the fact that you could bring in something that's broken and make something out of it.
Well, you want to know what I am dying to know about.
What?
Do you know?
Mm-mm.
This. What is this?
The hovercraft.
This is a hovercraft?
Yeah. Some people can also use hovercrafts for like boats and stuff.
What would you use this one for?
Well, this one's only like a prototype.
Okay.
Kind of like a playground thing.
Right, okay. So it's a test to see if
yeah.
it'll work. What is it made of, and how do you get this hoverboard prototype to hover?
The skirt is like what holds the bubble under it of
okay.
air.
So okay.
The bubble of air makes it lift off just barely.
And so that's why it's important that you have this little lip here. That's what you're talking about?
Well, kind of. That only keeps less like stuff touching on the ground and dragging it.
Okay. Okay. So a lot of importance goes into this shape, but then also
this.
What the heck is this?
That is a computer fan. I cut out a circle and then I use the computer fan's case to keep it secure.
Okay. And then I see a wire and some batteries. How do these fit into the equation?
I take 2 9-volt batteries and put them together, the negative to the positive. So then you have an 18-volt.
I've never seen that before.
The way that that works is the electric flow goes up here, then in a circle, then through that connection and out that way.
I just learned something today. Thank you, Liam. I appreciate that. Okay, now that I have been educated, tell me how this works with the connection and the wires and the power.
One line of this has a dotted white line, mm-hmm. and that is the positive. So I put it together. I put the wire and the positive, like, nub, I guess,
okay.
together, and then I put the negative onto the negative.
It's alive!
And then it can move.
Oh my gosh, it's Liam, it's moving.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be doing that.
Yes.
It's hovering. Did the computer fan have those lights in it already, or did you put the lights on it?
I wanted some lights, so I put them on.
Gives it some style. Thank you, Liam, for this fantastic demonstration. I feel like I should go invent something now. So you've inspired me and all of Dtown.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Now it's time to check out the kids at Camp Invention. Their assignment, to design an eco-adventure at Epic Park. They consider their location and then design the features of their adventure, including zip lining, tree houses, and more. Rachel West with Dtown live from Camp Invention. Let's see what's going on live on the scene. So what happened that you have to create a zip line? Why are you making a zip line?
So people can get across to other places.
Interesting. So as we speak, a zip line is being created and designed right now. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
So what's next in the plan, sir?
Right now we're trying to get it so it has an angle and it can fall down. Right now it has too much kinetic friction. It holds it up on the zip line.
throwing around some very good scientific terms there, kinetic friction. That's something I will look up later so I understand what that means. Can you tell me what that means?
Kinetic friction is like you're trying to drag your shoe on the carpet. It's hard, right?
Yeah.
Static friction, you can move it across something with pressure and it can still move.
All right, well, we'll let you get back to work, sirs. In Eco Park, as we speak right now, you are inventing a polar bear. How does it feel?
Fun.
What's the hardest part?
Building the feet.
The feet. You heard it here. The feet are the hardest part of building the polar bear. Well, we'll let you get back to work, sir.
We are building a porch, a deck sort of thing, up here in the tree. And then the person can be on the deck, and then there's going to be like a little hotel inside the tree.
When it's done, how many people will be able to stay inside this hotel tree area?
Probably like up to 75 or something people, so it's pretty small.
Yeah, but it still, that seems accurate to me. That's a pretty accurate calculation.
Looks good.
You want to move?
I feel like,
you want to tap
porch.
Into it?
How do you think
that?
All right, here we go. Well, yes, success.
Well, kind of.
Okay, what went wrong?
Well, we don't want them to be stranded in the middle. Oh.
The inventors collaborated on possible solutions to get the monkey all the way down the zip line.
Okay, so what are you hoping this is going to accomplish?
I'm hoping that this will make less kinetic friction.
And then that means there's less resistance?
Yes.
As it travels down. Did I get that right?
Yeah. Yes, you did.
In the meantime,
you need help coming up with an idea of what to put onto it.
I'm wondering if perhaps it might need some railing.
This.
Oh, this looks like some good railing areas. Okay.
I helped cut the railing for the tree hotel porch. Safety first.
How is the polar bear going?
Well, I changed it into a Pokemon.
Oh, so the polar bear design transformed into a Pokemon. Well, I like the Pokemon. Now, what's the red part?
Tree.
Okay, good.
The water.
So this is a water Pokemon. Have you named it?
It's a Squirtle.
So you have combined innovation with imagination and come up with a brand new Pokemon?
Mm-hmm.
Time to check back in and see how the zip line is coming.
What's your prediction on the zip line test?
I think it's going to work really good because if it goes too far, it's going to stop right there.
So you put a stopper on it so the monkey doesn't get injured. Let's see if this works. Launch! All right!
All right, Brenna, I've emerged from my Eco Park adventure. I feel like we've really designed some good problem-solving solutions and innovations. What's your take on it?
I would agree with you. It was good to see the changes and the inventor spirit live and well.
They're actually solving problems in real time and educating me. I've even learned some stuff. I'm going to go home and talk about kinetic and static friction energy. I'll get that straight later. But thank you, Brenna, for this awesome exploration of innovation. And these kids are awesome, and you are too. High five for that.
Thanks to Camp Invention, Brenna, and all our budding young inventors.
Oh, fruit for sale. Very good idea. Oh, we're still working on this eco-adventure here at Epic Park. We'll be right back in a minute. Now, how many are we going to sell? We have bananas and melons. And what are these?
Pop quiz. As mentioned earlier, the root beer float is also a local Denver invention. It was invented by Frank Wisner in 1893. What is the root beer float also known as? The black cow, brown fox, or brown derby? The answer, serve me up one of those delicious black cows. Here's a snappy idea, the Western Snap Shirt. Yep, also from right here in Denver. So how did this cool invention come about?
The Western fashion largely originated in Denver. And this goes back to my grandfather, Jack A. Weil, who made the first shirts with snaps. This element of fashion design began here in Denver and has become popular worldwide. You know, it's interesting that we have people walking in every day who are wearing it as a daily thing or as a weekend thing. We have rock stars that wear it. We get movies that pick it up. And we get lawyers and truck drivers and all kinds of people, and that's fascinating to me when a grandson likes it and a grandfather likes it. I think that's very cool when you cross those barriers.
Some of the rock stars that have worn the Western Snapshirt include Eric Clapton, Robert Plant, and Elvis. You can get your Western Snapshirts at Rock Mount Ranchwear in downtown Denver. Okay, so the inventive Jack Weil lived to be how old? 89, 98, or 107? The answer must be something to that Western living. He lived to be 107 years old. Denver is also home to the Mexican hamburger, basically a grilled patty in a tortilla smothered in green chili. Quite common in Denver Mexican restaurants, it may surprise Denverites that it's not so well known in the rest of the country, according to Westward Magazine. So it may not be the world-famous Mexican hamburger that the inventors claimed, yet anyway, but we're working on it. Which restaurant invented the Mexican hamburger? El Noa Noa, Las Delicias, or Joe's Buffet? The answer? While unfortunately no longer in business, it was Joe's Buffet on Santa Fe Drive. So what's your favorite Denver and Colorado invention? These are all pretty cool. Let's check the recap. Many fine inventions come from right here in Denver. We have a plaque to prove the cheeseburger came from the Mile High City. Yep, we've got the trademark. From the Humpty Dumpty Barrel restaurant in North Denver, the trademark was issued in 1935. And what goes perfectly with a cheeseburger? How about a root beer float, also known as a black cow and invented in Denver in 1893? And to top off the cheeseburger and root beer float, oh, well, maybe not so much, but also invented in Denver is shredded wheat by Henry Perkey in 1890. The Denver boot has been helping law enforcement for decades. It was invented by a Denver violinist, and it's been helping countless people avoid those towing fines for decades. Rock stars wear them, movie stars wear them, and you can too. It's the Western Snapshirt invented by Jack Weil. They're available at Rock Mount Ranchwear in downtown Denver. And back to food. The Mexican hamburger featuring a grilled patty and a tortilla with green chili is a Denver original from Joe's Buffet. Unfortunately, the restaurant is no longer here, but the Mexican hamburger lives on. Now, if you have an idea for an invention, don't spend a dime before it's time. Check with the Inventor Lady. She helps plenty of local inventors and can help you navigate the waters for your awesome idea. And if you've got a child, why not help them nurture their inventive spirit with Camp Invention? This program helps kids explore science, technology, and their own creativity right here at some of our own Denver public schools. So if you have an inventive streak, we hope you've been inspired to follow your vision. Either way, you can really impress your friends with all of your newfound knowledge about Denver's cool inventions. Until next time, enjoy. Woohoo! All right, success. Yes, back to more inventing.